And now we can talk all about everything you know about Citizens United. So we've been promising this for several weeks, and I kept derailing the conversation. So I'm going to shut up now. And
well, and I would derail it if I could. I tried to derail it, but you wouldn't let me.
No, we can have a.
I want my friend and the enemy of the people to defend himself, but we'll do that later. To
comment on his enemy status.
Yeah, clearly.
So my.
Sorry, a retired enemy of the people.
Right.
Yes,
I am reformed.
No, definitely not reformed at all.
Well,
I've taken enough grief here. So. Yes. So here's the
totally
deal.
Unmerited.
No, here's the deal on Citizens United. I'll give it to you very quickly.
Okay.
It was decided in 2010, and it will not be repealed in the next 10 years. So we should probably just not worry about it.
That's the short version.
All right. Tell us why you think it won't be repealed in the next 10 years.
First, we have to say what it is.
Well, it's a case that strikes down federal rules on political contributions, not by any means all political contributions, but it allows corporations to spend money independently of campaigns. They're still limited somewhat in their ability to contribute money directly to campaigns or individual candidates. But if they want to spend a lot of money saying in a congressional district, for example, that they think Congressman Jones is a schmuck and ought to be thrown out of office, corporations are free to do that. Quite specifically, the Supreme Court did not say that they could do this anonymously, although Justice Thomas believes they should be able to do it anonymously. The court gave room to the Congress to regulate the anonymity, quote unquote, the transparency of these contributions, but it said you cannot prevent them.
So what was it? I'm assuming that Citizens United was a company or a corporation that wanted to be able to spend more money than it was being allowed to.
Actually, I believe it was a nonprofit, but what it was quote a corporate entity, and it had made a movie trashing Hillary Clinton,
mm-hmm.
And it wanted the right to play that movie. Actually, in violation of, I believe, state rules about electioneering within a certain window of time before an election, and that was kind of what was. I mean, that was the specific case that was at issue. It was a very trashy piece of. It was a hit piece.
Yeah,
I don't think anybody would argue about that. But you know, hit pieces are perfectly legal under the First Amendment.
I wonder if the ruling would have been the same if the hit piece had been about George Bush.
I suspect so.
I think it would have.
That's good to know, and that makes me feel better, actually.
One of the challenges here for those of us who are fans of the First Amendment has always been to draw lines. If you want to hold something. If you want to say something is not protected by the First Amendment, you have to find a way to draw that line so that there aren't ways to sneak around it. And so as soon as you start saying that there's this line and it has to do with corporations and it has to do with political campaigning, but that's all it has to do with, then you have to start asking yourself, okay, how come it's not about this or that? You know, how do you hold that line? Slippery slopes are the great bugaboo of First Amendment fans like myself, And so I think there are a lot of us on the traditional First Amendment folks, as it were, if there is such a thing, who actually aren't terribly upset that the right, particularly the kind of justices that have recently assumed power within the Supreme Court, justices like Roberts and Alito, and presumably about to be Justice Gorsuch, are really kind of First Amendment oriented. They don't think you should restrain speech. Now, you can argue that the reason they don't want to restrain speech is because they got lots of money to spend on it. Their friends have lots of money to spend on it. And they don't want to see that kind of speech restrained. But once you start worrying about the slippery slopes and you start looking at, okay, if Citizens United is an okay, if it would be okay to restrain this kind of speech, then why isn't it okay to restrain some other kind of speech? So we're a little nervous about that. And well,
there's
terribly...
an underlying assumption in all of this that corporations really should have political rights as distinct from economic rights.
Yes.
And could you address that? Why does a corporation have political rights? They take it as a given in the majority opinion.
It's political, not just political rights, but the right to political speech. It's a very specific kind of, or it seemed to a layperson, it seemed like it was a very specific kind of.
Well, the problem you run into is, well, first of all, you have a sort of free assembly problem because corporations are assemblies of human beings, really, the shareholders who own a corporation.
Sure.
By forming a corporation, have taken advantage of certain protections that corporate form provides.
But that corporate form historically didn't provide political rights. It was an economic right, a series of economic rights for the purpose of encouraging investment, not for the purpose of speaking out against the king. That had nothing whatever to do with it. And I think ancient people looking at ancient people like me looking at the role of the formation of a corporation in English and American history, it had nothing whatever to do with political rights. Where did that come in? When did they get political rights and why?
Well,
and I hate to bring up, you know, get behind, because once you accept that they have political rights, everything that the majority in this case says pretty much follows. And the dissent, you can agree with the dissent, as people generally do, in the sense that we've opened the door to too much money spending, too much spending, and giving corporations and presumably labor unions as well much too much political power simply by the use of their money in politics. And that's what the dissent is all about. And that's what the screaming about Citizens United is all about.
But the question of when did political rights get ascribed?
Well, I'm raising the question, why should they have any of these rights at all? That's not what forming corporations is ever about.
So that's...
It was to limit liability by investors and thus encourage them to invest in one or another economic idea.
Well, you know, far be it from me to get too excited about arguing with Abe about this. It certainly wouldn't break my heart if Citizens United disappeared. I'm suggesting, I guess, a couple of things. One is that there is... Citizens United is consistent with a certain view of the First Amendment that ultimately is protective.
Of the First Amendment.
Which was not the view of the Supreme Court until Citizens United. The regulation of those political rights was virtually a given in this country. In fact, when I started out as a lawyer, the first case I had was an alleged violation of a $5,000 contribution limit by a defense contractor on Long Island, whose name shall not be mentioned because he's still there. Much bigger than he used to be. And those things like donating to political journal, having a dinner, you know, where every corporation in the county had a little thing in the, had a little ad in the political, in the Republican Party or Democratic Party journal for the county dinner. You know, these things are very regulated and hotly litigated. Obviously, we've come a very long way since then.
So did Citizens United pretty much just in protecting that band of free speech, the corporate right to free speech, was Citizens United when the justices who voted for it, when they wrote their opinion, did they cite precedent? Did they cite anything that addressed what Abe had talked about originally, the idea that something somewhere along the line had given corporations the rights that an individual would have to the right of free speech, to treat a corporation like an entity, singular?
Well, there is a string of cases that have developed since about the time Abe was off litigating with Long Island developers.
Defense contractors.
Yeah. Well, you know, developers, defense contractors, Russians, they're all the same. This line of cases has to do with, quote, commercial speech. And right. Abe is correct that prior to this line of cases, certainly, and maybe in the sense that he's talking about it, cases since then, were limited to the kinds of speech that advanced specific interests of the corporation.
Like you'd see with a labor union, or
yes, or just advertising.
Advertising was the
main advertising was the. There were some other things. There was a Supreme Court opinion in Bilotti that had to do with essentially, I believe, the right to the corporation to speak about a matter that directly affected its interests, and these. This whole doctrine of commercial speech sort of progressed within, frankly, the First Amendment legal community that I was part of as a newspaper lawyer. And, you know, most of us didn't care a whole lot, but the principles that were being argued were difficult to separate from the principles that protected the New York Times company, a corporation, in litigation situations that it got involved in. Mm-hmm. So there again, it's more about the slippery slope than mm-hmm. about the specific rights here. But I guess at the end of the day, I come back to, what are we going to do about it? There isn't much we can do about it, and not likely to be much we can do about it for some time to come, other than in take the opportunity, if we get successful in a in an electoral context, more mm-hmm. successful than recently, to advance the transparency rules that allow people to know who's buying what. And I don't think, honestly, at the national level, Citizens United has made a whole lot of difference.
That was one question.
It has made a lot of difference, probably in particular local races, particularly congressional races, where someone like the Coke companies can show up and essentially buy a congressional election at the local level, or even a state legislative race of some kind, or a state initiative of some sort.
Right.
These kinds of things, however, depend on voters saying, oh yeah, I love the Koch brothers and I think I want to do whatever they ask me to do. Mm-hmm. Now, if that's the way the voters in a particular district feel, well, you know, we're SOL. But if the voters are simply being fooled into thinking that all this noise that's coming from somewhere, who knows where, must be a sign that Congressman Smith is not a good person, and so therefore I'll vote against him. What we need to happen is for the citizens to unite and say, no, all this stuff is coming from the Koch brothers, for God's sake. And why in the world would I vote for what they want? They certainly aren't interested in my interests. So I should vote the other way just because all this money is being spent.
But if the Koch brothers are putting out propaganda that makes that says you should trust what the Koch brothers have to say, and that's how they're advancing the political argument of their candidates instead of allowing the people who are voting in whatever area, nationally or locally, instead of letting them make decisions on their own based on facts, if they're poisoning the well, then their speech isn't so free anymore. They're buying it, and they're buying access to people in a way that's disingenuous. And I know there's nothing in the First Amendment that stops you from doing that. It's not fire in a crowded theater.
Lincoln secretly owned a newspaper.
What?
The founder of the company that I worked for 35 years bought his first newspaper in the early 1900s because he wanted to run for Congress. And a newspaper was a good asset to do that with. So, there's there's a long history of elections being bought and sold.
Well, I think what you were talking about before, the public, I think what you're saying is the public ought to have a right, and to some extent it does, but not fully, to know who's spending all this money and saying that Smith is a pedophile, therefore don't vote for him. What we see mostly are sort of trumped up organizational names.
Yes, I see a lot of
this
that.
This commercial is, this message is paid for by citizens
Americans
opposed to pedophilia. And who the hell is that? Who the hell is that? Is what the dissent is really about in this case, in Citizens United, that's what's going to happen, that buckets of money are going to be thrown at candidates, and we're not going to know, other than the fact that it's probably corporate money, we're not going to know who it is.
So the dissent was more predictive about the negative repercussions of society?
Oh, absolutely.
Is that
the dissent,
true?
The dissent was absolutely right about that. Doesn't mean that they were right on the strict First Amendment issue that Hal is talking about. In fact, as I read it the other day, I was really taxed because if you really believe in the First Amendment, even understanding that the waters are polluted by so much money coming in here. Right. By Citizens United. As I said earlier, if you accept the fact that corporations, organizations, labor unions have political rights, have the rights of political speech, not just commercial speech, then we have our slippery slope that Al was talking about. It's very hard to get, if you acknowledge that, it's very hard to get to the point of saying you can deny them.
Is that true, speech. Though, for other Supreme Court cases where the dissent isn't so much arguing the facts of the case or the letter of the law versus the spirit of the law, but more arguing the likely outcomes in the future?
Well, it's a public policy. Whenever you have a court deciding cases on the basis of what they think is good public policy, like minimum wages or voting to uphold child labor laws, go back.
Right, but I'm thinking.
Those are public policy decisions that to say that they're constitutionally based, they're constitutionally based because the court majority can fashion an argument within the Constitution to support it.
I'm talking like Brown versus the Board of Education.
All right.
When in a case like that, would the dissent have been, and I know that's not fair because you guys, I didn't say anything about it and you didn't read it recently, but in general, is the dissent something that is pretty, like with a slippery slope? If you start letting them in, then look at all these horrible things that are going to start happening. Or was the that kind of case decided on and dissented on actual constitutional arguments?
Oh, no, there were constitutional arguments in the dissent in this case. Citizens United, there were four justices in the dissent, and they certainly had their constitutional principles, their reading of the First Amendment. But the strongest part of the opinion was the prediction of what likely was going to happen.
Right.
And as to that, as you pointed out, Heather, they were right on. They were absolutely right.
Well, it's very interesting, though, because what Hal said earlier and what the lobbyist said, because I think, I can't remember if I've seen you guys since I went down to D.C. for a bar mitzvah and I got to sit at a table full of and a room full of lobbyists for.
Oh, how dreadful.
I'm sorry. Oh,
I know.
What a terrible day that was.
Talk about a slippery slope.
And yet, you know, these were all people who were lobbying for really interesting. I mean, it wasn't the John Birch Society. It was a really interesting group of people who were all out fighting the good fight. And I just asked a lot of questions. But when I mentioned that we did this podcast and that we were going to be dealing with Citizens United, the host plopped down next to me and said, I have always wondered if there is any proof that any damage has been done because of Citizens United. And I started to say, I think that sounds like proving a negative, which would be problematic, but I'll pose the question because it feels to me like the same question of saying, well, did Russian hacking affect the outcome of the election, or did all of that crazed frenzy for Y2K, all of the money that got dumped into updating all of the software, did that save us, or was it not a problem to begin with? How can you tell? Is there a trail that people can follow to be able to go, look, this is what Citizens United hath wrought?
Well, I don't know the answer to that. Hal said before that it likely has had much more of an impact in state and local elections, where it's easier to see that throwing a pile of money in a congressional district can have a disproportionate impact.
I wonder
if it
would be as bad if we weren't as gerrymandered as we were. Or it wouldn't feel so bad if you
I don't know. I think that's an important issue, but I don't think it's this one. I think that's part of attempts by certain parts of the body politic to try and limit the vote, presumably to people who are friendlier to their persuasion. I think that's an appalling problem in this country. And I see corporate spending as part of that problem, but it stands on somewhat different footing.
Okay.
I don't want to get into the argument because we could talk about that a different day, and perhaps should, about the attempts to limit the franchise in this country because they're getting much, much worse as days goes on. And it's very dangerous.
Yes. Disenfranchised people carry pitchforks.
AK-47s and
yeah, right. It's different times, I'm afraid. I think that the amount of money thrown at elections generally is, of course, a great deal of it is going into television, mm-hmm. which just eats up money.
Yeah. And where's the FCC in that? It's not free speech.
I don't know what the regulations are. Even.
Well, there is no.
How would know?
As a practical matter, today there is no FCC regulation as I knew it in my youth when we had things like the Fairness Doctrine.
The Fairness Doctrine, right.
Yeah, and the equal time rules that applied. They weren't. I mean, the fact is, we have 500 channels or 900 channels or 2,500 channels today, and the whole First Amendment rationale, to the extent there ever was one, for those rules was scarcity. There is no scarcity today, so it's very difficult to justify that kind of regulation.
That makes a lot of sense.
You're disagreeing, Heather?
No. I'm saying
that moan.
No. I mean, one of the reasons why I really wanted to do this is because it's so easy to say, "Well, that's stupid." But if you don't know why something is happening, how can you tell whether it's stupid or not?
Well, I think the scarcity argument, if it's limited on its face to the availability of channels and the availability of the internet, I mean, that makes a lot of sense. The dissent in Citizens United makes a scarcity type of argument in that, although there's a lot of money around, it's concentrated wealth when thrown into the political arena that's going to create a lack of balance.
So that lack of balance.
That's the heart of the sort of scarcity argument, that you just can't match what corporation, you can't match corporate money.
Well, what's the flip side?
We seem
of that?
To believe that that's true. That's a sort of scarcity argument.
Well, but what was the dissent was saying that this is going to localize a whole lot of political speech and power in the hands of these corporations and without transparency. What was the deciding, what was the decision on the side that was pro the Citizens United thing? What was the warning to them in not making this case go through? Because there had to be a downside that they saw, or maybe not.
Oh, you mean, well, yes, there was a downside. Rich people didn't get to use their money exactly in the free way that that they should. I mean, that's the argument.
The sucky argument.
Yeah. So there is a libertarian strain here.
Yeah.
Really very small percentage of the electorate accepts, understands, grasps, is moved by what moves the members of the Federalist Society, like Alito and Chief Justice Roberts, and I wouldn't even put Scalia in that camp because he came along before there was a Federalist Society. But these are people who are brought up in a judicial tradition that believe that it's all about individual rights. And whether corporations should have individual rights is kind of a side issue. Once you say that they should, then it's real easy to get to Citizens United.
Right.
If you can find a way to keep corporations from being citizens, then you can easily find a way to limit their rights. But they weren't able to do that, not surprisingly.
Yeah.
But there's, you know, much of the fundamental difference between the more principled arguments on both sides in our polarized society has to do with the role of equality and the role of freedom. Mm-hmm. There's a clash between those two.
Yeah.
And if you want to structure the government and the rules that we play by to advance equality, then you're going to damage freedom. You're going to limit freedom.
Sure.
And that's the fact is, this split informs a lot of what's happening around us, very, very few voters think of it in those terms.
Yeah.
But when you get to people like the justices of the Supreme Court, And you can see it on both sides in this case. These are very important concepts and very important disputes. And they take you in entirely different directions. And sometimes I keep saying that there is a strain within the Republican Party that believes that it's good for society if we let sick people die in the streets. Right. It's their right to do that. They're free to do that. If we advance those freedoms, then the chances of them actually dying in the streets are reduced because they will see that their self-interest requires them to be better behaved. It's a kind of spanking argument, you know. Spanking is good for you. It will cause you to do the right thing, which of course it never has and never will.
That it's ever worked.
On the other hand, are those of us who say, look, we can't let people die in the streets, even if they're exercising their own rights in ways that cause them to end up under the wheels of horseless carriages, then we need to pull them back and not let them do that. Well, if you really get into that, that divide, it takes you into lots of things you wouldn't think about. Makes things that otherwise look easy or sometimes hard look hard or easy in that way of thinking about things.
Yeah, because there's...
you've got an underlying assumption in the freedom argument that people actually are exercising their freedom to die in the street.
Instead of being put in a position where there's no choice but to...
Yeah.
Exactly. That's exactly right. And, for good or bad, I don't buy the argument because there is no exercise of freedom there at all, except for wealthy people making the argument to not support the body politic, which is an argument they have always made. And the freedom argument carried out to its extremes, as some folks would like to carry it, is anarchy.
But it seems to me that the point where all of these things intersect is the social contract. And I have a very specific example. It never occurred to me that somebody's freedoms could infringe on somebody else's rights until we moved to Brooklyn. And Andrew and I were sitting out in the backyard, and it was a beautiful day, and it was Sunday morning, and the birds are chirping, and we had our coffee and the newspaper, and holy crap. Yeah, until our neighbors start cranking their music. It's like nine in the morning on a Sunday, and it's the which, under normal circumstances, I think I wouldn't have cared one way or the other, but their what they were calling their right to play music as loud as I want was infringing on my right to have a quiet Sunday morning, damn it.
Correct.
And it seems to me that that's where the social contract has started to fall apart over the last, it's probably always been frayed along the edges in this. I think libertarianism sounds great as long as everybody is exactly the same and all agrees that you're going to stop at the intersection because there's no stop sign or light anymore. But you agree that you're going to stop there, then it all works just fine. But once everybody's awareness of the rules starts to change, and I think Citizens United is a great example of a place where that's happened because of what Hal was saying, that a layperson like me wouldn't necessarily understand that because of Citizens United, the onus is even more on me to pursue information on the political speech that I'm hearing. I need to be more responsible about going and finding the background, and that's not a bad thing.
In and of itself, that responsibility on a citizen is a good thing.
Yeah, and we should be doing that.
But everything we talk about in this and every society is line drawing. How far is worthwhile here? When you when you admit that citizens are not going to carry out those responsibilities, except as Hal was suggesting before, in very small numbers.
Right.
The question comes in fairly sharp relief is, to what extent, if any, should we be protecting the voter?
Right, because then you get into questions of the nanny.
Well, that's what Citizens United and all the cases that led up to it, and all the ones that followed, they're all in that vein, and it goes back to the freedom argument. Of course, should we be protecting the body politic, or are we all on our own, or somewhere in the middle? That's what all this is. And, you know, we can transfer that issue to almost any issue between Republicans and Democrats and the fringes of around them. They're all situations like that, between total freedom on one hand, which I suppose nobody seriously talks about, to total protectionism on the other, which nobody really seriously talks about, not in this country anyway, because we're not that kind of, we're somewhere, you know, to the left or right of the middle most of the time. Right now, we're moving in a direction that people in the center are very unhappy with. Certainly people on the left are very unhappy with, but that's what we got from our electoral college. But that issue, the issue of protection of society, whether it's Obamacare, or whether it's voting rights, it's always the same issue.
So
where is it? How far do you go? What's the proper role, if any, of government? I mean, there are lots of people in Washington right now that say government should not have a role here.
Yes, I understand.
Have the army, but that's it.
I can appreciate that. I can disagree with it, but I can appreciate it because that's a rational. There is a rational argument to be made there, but Hal, there's another freedom of speech thing that's been happening lately, and I was really glad we were going to talk about both corporations having the right to free speech in the way that Citizens United outlined it, but also the most recent press conference made me wonder if there's has there ever been any kind of limitation on free speech placed upon a president? Because there's a divisiveness that is coming from the bully pulpit and dangerously, I think, and a straightforward attack on the press. And if we can't trust our press, and he quoted Jefferson, which ticked me off so much. He quoted old Jefferson when Jefferson was all pissy because they didn't like him. But if he quoted young Jefferson when Jefferson was all hot-headed and revolutionary, they would have found something a little bit different. So I don't know. Can Trump say the things that he says with complete impunity?
Well, of course he can.
Sure.
It's not yelling. Yeah. It's really not yelling fire in a crowded theater when he says to the entire country?
I have to go back to Lincoln.
All right, I'll let you do that.
prior to the Civil War, the press had become, thanks to technological advancements,
mm-hmm.
Having to do with the ability to print large quantities of newspapers at relatively low prices.
Right.
The press became much more of an egalitarian institution. Everybody who was literate, and more people were literate, read newspapers. Literate people had been reading newspapers for a long time. But they were a relatively small piece of the population, and their access to newspapers, to printed material, was somewhat limited because of the cost of producing it, distributing it, the distances they had to travel, that sort of thing. So there's a whole history here that we tend to lose sight of. We tend, on our side of the argument, to think that newspapers have, and the media, quote unquote, have always been servants of the people, not enemies of the people, and that there the publications, even our local daily newspapers, which are struggling with having lost half their revenue in the last decade,
right,
and getting crapped on all the time because they keep laying off journalists, right, because they don't have any advertising revenue to pay them with. They are not philanthropies. They are corporations almost always, although they can be, you know, individually owned. And so we think that the press is, it has always been independent, objective, honest, and the sort of a teddy bear that we need to hang on to.
Except for that whole yellow journalism section of the country's history.
And in fact, a lot of journalists buy into this nonsense. But the fact is, by the Civil War, almost all publications were highly partisan. And the owners of those publications participated actively in politics. They gave money. They certainly shaped their coverage to support particular sides. At the beginning of the Civil War, the Democratic newspapers were anti-union, basically. The Republican newspapers were more likely to be pro-union. And this continued on because as the technology that made cheap newspapers possible meant that many communities had multiple newspapers to draw on as their sources of information, even small communities. And they were, you know, you could have a Republican paper. There are newspapers in this country today that are named the ex-Republican. Mm-hmm. There are newspapers in this country that are named the ex-Democrat. Because they were, I don't mean ex-Democrat, I mean the Democrat.
Yes.
They were originated as partisan periodicals. When the predecessor of my owners bought his newspaper in Aurora, Illinois in 1906 so he could run for Congress because that would help him get elected, what was he doing? There were other newspapers in town. It was the Aurora Beacon that he bought. Well, ultimately, he bought the News and merged them into the Beacon News. And that trend, when that occurred, it became harder and harder for a local newspaper to be partisan because you lost half your audience. And, hey, the money came from being able to sell advertisers on the notion that if you advertised in the Beacon News, you could reach everybody. And if you could only reach the Democrats, well, it's hard to sell Snickers, you know, it was hard. So this notion that they should be independent, objective, nonpartisan vehicles is a creature of the 20th century.
So really, really, it was the scarcity issue again, that when there was only one paper in town, that paper in town was going to have to satisfy the broadest range of...
Well, it was in their interest to do so. Now, not all of them always did what was in their interest.
That's right.
Well, I seem to recall there was a morning paper, which was one side, and then an afternoon paper that was leaned the other way.
Yeah, well, that was... originally, though, they were actually published in the same cycles. But then over time, they did tend to, as part of this progress, they tended to move toward different niches, morning and afternoon. It was World War II that kind of began the collapse of multiple newspaper towns. And so by the 1960s, there were fewer and fewer cities with even small communities that had multiple newspapers. Mm-hmm. And not all of them suddenly became even-handed, objective. The Los Angeles Times did it in 1960 at a very clear departure point when Otis Chandler was named the publisher as a result of the machinations of his mother, whose other family members were mostly John Birch Society members. They're still out there today, so I won't actually name them, but their descendants are. And it was Otis who said, hey, We got to serve both sides. And this pissed the hell out of Richard Nixon, who up until that point had been in bed with the Los Angeles Times. Right. They had a wonderful working relationship. And when he ran for governor, they had suddenly decided they were an objective publication. And he lost his leverage with him. And that's why he said, and he directed this to the Los Angeles Times correspondent, Dick Burkholz, "You won't have Dick Nixon to kick around
anymore." Oh, that's when that happened.
Yes.
Oh my God.
But unfortunately, he was even then not telling the truth, although he probably thought it was the truth at the time.
That man had the worst luck when it came to stuff like that.
Yeah.
That's hilarious.
So all I'm trying to set up here is the notion that, and certainly in Lincoln's time, there's a wonderful book by Harold Holzer, who is probably the most definitive of today's historians of Lincoln. He's written dozens of books about him. He's written a book called Lincoln and the Press that describes not only Lincoln's relationship with the press, but he gives you a good picture of the entire landscape of the press in the 1860s, the 1850s, 60s. And you see the way in which Lincoln used the press and was used by the press. And for someone like me, I can sort of look at that and say, well, you know, I feel better about Donald Trump. I feel better because I know that somehow or other we survived that and that we will survive what we're involved in now. What we have now is, in some ways, what we had when we had a partisan press. We still do have partisan journals, but mostly we have partisan TV.
Yes.
We also have nonpartisan TV. When he tweeted that famous tweet that called us the enemy of the people, yes. He named CBS, NBC, and ABC, whose network news and affiliations are pretty straight down the middle. Yes, NBC has MSNBC, which is not at all straight down the middle.
No, nope. But it's not.
He named CNN, which is pretty trying desperately to be straight down the middle.
Yeah.
And then, of course, there's Fox, which doesn't even pretend anything. It just pretends. And in addition to that visual stuff, which is probably the most powerful in terms of moving people's souls.
Absolutely.
There's the Breitbart kinds of things. There's all kinds of online publications of various ideological stripes, all of which, when I say they are pushing a line, they believe in the line, or at least there's some rational reason why they are advancing the lines they are advancing.
Sometimes it's just for ad revenue.
Yeah, sometimes it's just for ad revenue, and sometimes it's just for the hell of it. When you have a president saying what he said, you have a president who has, not got quite all of his marbles, frankly. Or maybe he has more marbles than I'd like to give him credit for. Maybe he knows exactly what he's doing, and maybe it will have the effect that he wants. I'm not really sure. But I do know that the press doesn't say, oh, my God, he thinks we're the enemy of the people. We have to change and be different. That's not what's going to happen.
No, that's not going to happen.
And if he thinks we're the enemy of the people, then we really must be his enemy, because we're not the enemy of the people, and we're going to goddamn well show him. I mean,
the blowback that he's gotten from his work.
Yeah.
He keeps saying, he has a reason for taking this position. He's not the first president to take it, although he's taken it a lot further than any president ever did. I mean, Nixon talked about the press being the enemy, but it was his personal enemy, and it was in the context of, we've got to keep things away from the press or they'll find out about us. That was in the context of Watergate. So that had nothing with the context of Trump's saying it is, maybe he's just crazy. But I think there's a deliberateness to create an enemy that he can constantly do battle with. I think that's important to him. And
because he has to win.
And he thinks that he's got a massive following out there that really hates the press and sees the press in the manner in which he describes it. I think, to be sure, there are lots of people out there, because we have lots of people who think in all kinds of odd ways. But my hope is he's wrong about that, that his, the more he pushes this button, the less he's going to get out of it, because there's definitely real blowback from this.
Well, that's one of the things, though, that I find so concerning. For instance, all of the attention on how batty the press conference was. If you watched the whole thing, if you watched snippets from it, you didn't get the sense that something had derailed.
I watched a lot of it, and he's crazy.
It was an incredible display of all sorts of things.
Talk about blowback on this. But enemy of the press. Look who blew. Where the blowback comes, not just obviously it comes from the press, as it should, but his own Secretary of Defense. Disagrees with him.
But
you get the John McCain's finally coming out of the forest.
And thank God.
And screaming. I think it's more that when Mattis starts screaming at him, I think that's very important. That people that who are supposed to be working for him are really disagreeing with him.
Except for the one person who matters. There's only one person who matters out of everybody that you said, and it's Bannon, who invited himself onto the NSC. And the thing that worries me over and over every night that I watch news or when I read stuff online, and how this gets to the speech thing too, is the speech that we're paying attention to, the crazy stuff, is not the speech we need to be paying attention to. There are things that have been signed that are so desperately important. They're now allowing the coal mines to dump waste into rivers, having said incorrectly that 70,000 miners now are going to keep their jobs that would have lost it if Obama's plan had gone through, when in fact the cleanup would have made jobs and not taken any coal miners' jobs away.
Well,
but this stuff is lost in this maelstrom of crazy.
There's something to that.
The person that matters here is not Steve Bannon. The person that matters here is the American voter.
That's a nice advertisement there.
The people, we have met the enemy, and he is us. Okay?
He is us.
You're Pogo.
The people elected this guy, and admittedly, they elected him in an electoral environment that has been skewed by a lot of politicking that got us gerrymandered districts and got us various acts to discourage voting. But at the end of the day, he got elected, okay, by the people of the United States. He's right.
Some of them.
They elected him, you know, by the rules of the Constitution. They elected the son of a bitch.
Constitutional,
okay,
yes.
And so we're going to have to diselect him. We're going to have to find ways to move the electorate beyond this patch.
Yes.
And that's not easy to come up with a solution for.
No, it's very difficult. But the press is an urgent part of that.
Yes, it is. And if you look, I think I can't leave this discussion without saying in the clearest terms I can that there is the New York Times. There is the Wall Street Journal.
Yes.
And we disagree. We may disagree with their opinions because both of them publish a lot of opinions.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm.
But their news coverage is as straight as it can be.
Yes.
There are three networks that fool around with all kinds of stuff I wish they wouldn't fool around with. Mm-hmm. But they don't lie to us about the basic issues of the day. And
no, they don't.
And we cannot forget the Associated Press, which is the principal source of information about national and international issues for every newspaper in the country and most of the broadcast outlets as well.
Yeah.
And the AP is maybe not strong as it would like to be, but it's healthy and is still providing the basic facts that underpin our democracy. So long as those things are continuing to do what they do now, then eventually Donald Trump will fade into history. He'll fade into history even if they don't, because he's a human being, right, and he'll die.
How do we encourage the press then, especially if in my mind I see the AP feed going out to all of these places, and that's why I see everybody covering the same things with the same level of intensity, so that it's there was an hour there for a while when the half brother of Kim Jong-un was poisoned, murdered in front of everybody. Yeah, murdered in front of everybody at an airport. I did see that coverage. And so there was a break in the crazy person story. But again, I'm following websites that actually list the executive orders on a daily basis, uh-huh, and give links out to background so that you can see, like, why did this happen? And I'm not, it feels to me like we would have an easier time. Well, it feels to me like we would have an easier time of coalescing back together again if the people on TV stop looking like they're snarking at Trump and instead just stick to what's going on, not the crazy puppet who's over here trying to get your attention, but to the actual stuff that's going to affect their lives. And I don't know how to nudge the press that direction to say, look, is it just that it sells more papers and more advertising? Probably.
It did during the campaign. And that was one of the things that a lot of people believe led to Trump's victory, was the press was too busy selling advertising off of him.
So how can we
the president of CBS said so.
How do news outlets, how do they listen to us? Is it good question. Just
I mean,
dollars?
That's a great question. How do you get your news outlet
I would argue that you may have it backwards. The news outlets are looking at us, and they are asking us what it is we will respond to, and they are delivering it.
Oh, God.
And so we have to, as the people, the American people, we have to assert ourselves and show that we are the enemy, not the press.
And we need to get ourselves in gear.
We need to get ourselves together. We need to figure out what matters to us, what really matters to us. And we need to take steps. We need to take actions to advance those things that we care about, that mean something for our grandchildren, mm-hmm, and our great-grandchildren. And that's what will happen. That's what will make the change. Again, I'm optimistic about this only because after this many million years, the human race still survives, despite having the same kinds of quirky failures over and over and over again. I feel like I live in the best possible time in the history of the world in most respects, not counting Donald Trump.
And now I know that I'm going to call you Hal Candide. That's your new name. I think that's a wonderful place to leave it, though, because, hey, we
too
can be upbeat and hopeful.
I think that's great. I think Hal's really led us right off the air.
If you knew my grandkids, you'd know why I feel the way I do.
Well, we see you posting pictures of them all the time. So.
And a clean table, too.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, thank you guys so much for doing this for another week. And I think we should probably move on from the First Amendment after 4,000 episodes. But Hal, I would love to be able to call you back when things get weird.
Good.
That would be fantastic. Thank you so much.
I'm going to New York for theater and symphonies on Thursday. And
how wonderful.
I may just never come back.
Yeah.
Actually, from there, I'm going to see some other grandkids. In
DC, good.
So. And go to a gridiron dinner.
All right. Have a wonderful time, and we'll see you when you get home. If and when you get home,
travel safely.
Okay.
Adios, thanks, guys. Bye.
Bye.